we talk about the English profile and referring to it as an evolution of the work that was done originally with the Threshold series. English profile, of course, as in the case of the other reference level descriptions like Profile Deutsch, is trying to describe the whole range of levels that are now in the framework. Interestingly, some of the research which is coming out, some of the analysis from the research, I should say, which has been based on a closer look at learner language, as well as looking at what teachers do and what learners apparently are asked to learn, has to some extent endorsed what was in the earlier series. So by comparing the analysis from the framework model, which is using corpora, with the T level, you've been able to see to what extent the two things which come from the two periods are convergent. And it's interesting that at the bottom end, particularly from the way stage and the threshold, that there is a lot which is endorsed by the analysis of the learner data. I think that's very encouraging.
Mm-hmm. Yes, in many ways it is, yes. But it's not to be presupposed.
Not to be presupposed, and so some things, so when of you course,
talk
are
about,
not.
When you talk about the RLDs, the reference level description, fleshing out the categories in the framework, the possibility has to be left open that they won't simply flesh it out, that they may find that for that particular language or for that particular group of learners, it needs modification.
And that particularly perhaps around the area of the functional descriptors.
Yes.
We've mentioned the top level, the C level, but perhaps more so, and because there are many more people in the category, at the lower end. So at the in the A1 level, the descriptors are perhaps not adequate.
Well,
for many learners,
yes.
I mean,
they're not entirely coherent. Mm. The work that I did on breakthrough, I wanted to maintain the widest functional range, with the minimum possible means, and to apply this very strongly. Mm. But also to take advantage of of other competences, heuristic competences, the ability to discover or to deduce meanings for unfamiliar material, which somebody with a very, very limited knowledge of a language has to do.
Mm-hmm. These are learning strategies or using
and
strategies.
But there are some indications, because of this tendency, which I mentioned, to relegate statements of incompetence down to the low levels, the initial learning being of a phrase book kind, just learning rehearsed formulae. And I didn't think that was characteristic of human learning. Mm. As soon as you have a certain amount of knowledge of a language, as a human being, you start experimenting with it. Mm. And you don't simply confine yourself to learning off by heart the formulae required for getting petrol at a filling station or something. So in some places, the A level, the A1 competence looks as if it is very formulaic, and in others it looks as if it is the maximum exploitation of very simple structures. Mm. And I would like to see the second and not the first. Mm. Although you do at any stage in your language learning rely quite a bit on pre-formulated utterances that are appropriate to a particular occasion. And it's probably stronger at A1 than it is at higher levels, but it's typical of all.
But it's what you're pointing out is also the issues that arise when the framework is used to structure learning for broader ranges of learner groups. So
yes,
at the low levels, you increasingly find children learning other languages in school from an age of 6 or 7 even. And in other contexts, you find learners who are adult who come to learning another language without necessarily having had a great deal of education in their first language or in their own culture. These two groups were not really targeted when the framework was originally conceived.
That's right. And in fact, the differences of audience of this sort, this differentiation applies not only at the lowest levels, it implies all the way up.
Mm-hmm.
The way that it looks is that the higher up the scale you get, the more the descriptions look like descriptions for language use in higher education for native speakers.
Mm.
You may have people who have a very, very complete and fluent knowledge of the language for the purposes of the lives they lead, but which are not highly intellectual in character.
You're talking about native speakers now.
I'm talking about both native speakers and language learners. Mm. And we have tended, because of the whole history of languages in educational systems, to overstate the intellectual requirements and to understate the requirements for the adequate expression of emotions, attitudes.
And indeed, these are manifestations now of the evolutionary process, I think, around the framework. Teams working with children and setting learning objectives for children, whether in Norway or Japan or in the UK, have been working on descriptors which will help to characterize learning objectives for children who are not yet out in the real world, as it were, having to do functional tasks, but their world is the classroom.
And if you take adult learners in English, but perhaps even more for some other less widely taught languages, there is a huge difference between what is required to integrate immigrants into the life of the society and what is required for foreigners on a summer course wishing to pick up a basic knowledge of the language.
Mm-hmm.
The requirements of these two groups are really quite different.